for our inner life. That's my topic this morning. 1 Thessalonians 5, 16 through 18 contains three short orders. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks at all circumstances. This is the will of God for our everyday life. Joy is the one thing everyone wishes to have always in his life. And that can happen to us only if we pray continually and give thanks at all times for everything. That is what this verses in 1 Thessalonians teaching us. It is easy for most of the people, even those who are in the world, to rejoice when everything is going great. Some will give thanks when things are going well, and some only few continue to pray when things are going great. Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances are the principle for our inner life, for our daily peaceful life. And in relationship with God, most of us struggle with our emotions and thought life. The force of emotions is what make the individual preoccupied, and we cannot flee from our feelings. Therefore, we must deal with them. Where do these amazing things like emotions and feeling come from? It is from our very being, from our soul and spirit. That's the reason our inner life should be influenced by the Holy Spirit. For this purpose, Jesus died on the cross to send the Holy Spirit to live inside. John 16:7, Jesus said, "While I was in this earth," he was telling to the disciples, "it is for your advantage that I go away. For if I don't go away, the helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send to you the Holy Spirit." So we need the Holy Spirit of Christ in our spirit to change and control our thinking, change and control our emotions. We need to be influenced by the. It is not only that, even after accepting Jesus Christ, after having Holy Spirit inside, many are not influenced by the Holy Spirit of God. So we should be influenced by the Spirit of God that is dwelling inside us. Then only our thinking will change, our emotions will change. So people of this world are filled with despair and gloom. Yes, the pressure from many sides can do this, but for a person who is in Christ, who is born again, baptized, his life is different. He is now in Christ, understood the purpose of his life and the purpose of being saved, that is to change and become a new person of character, to secure life eternal after his death. So now the born again person has a new vision and an additional goal in his life. He is able to understand the reality of his existence, his birth in this world, and the existence of God and God's love toward him. And Mark 8:36 and Matthew 16:26 says, Jesus is telling, "What good it will be for you if you gain the whole earth yet forfeit your soul." To obey those impossible commandments like rejoice and pray and give thanks always, we must have experienced the new birth, so that we have Christ's Spirit to dwell in us, to influence us. Without the help of Holy Spirit, no one can rejoice always, no one can pray always, no one can give thanks always. Not once in a while, Bible says, not is here. Always, continually. So as we learn to abide in Him and trust in Him to work, and we trust in Him for God to work through us, we will progressively start changing as we start working with Him, and we will slowly we will be conformed to Christ's image. Jesus was always rejoicing, He was always praying, He was always thankful. And but if we remain rigid, cold and self-centered, having doubt and confusion about all what God says, and if we are not set our mind to honor Him and respect Him through obedience of the word of God. Many people say, "Yes, I do respect Jesus, I do honor Him," but they don't obey Him. So through obedience only we can respect and honor Him. So we cannot have this joy always if you don't honor Jesus Christ through obedience. But if we believe, as 2 Timothy 3:16 says, all scripture is breathed out by God for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness. So if we believe that, we do study the word for our correction, not just for our head knowledge, and for our reproof and training in righteousness. And then we can obey the word of apostle who says, count it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials and temptation, James 1:2. And when we face with troubles and temptations in life of various degrees, as 1 Peter 4:12 and 13 says, we should not be surprised as though something strange is happening to us. After we are born again, baptized, as in the world, we used to think we are the most unlucky person. Every person will think, why I am born, or why I am born in this family, or why I am in this earth. Why only struggle for me, only. That's what people will think. But after we are in Christ, after we are born again, baptized, we should understand the purpose, and we should understand. And those, Peter says in 4th chapter 12 and 13, we should not be surprised as if some strange thing is happening to us, but we should rejoice sharing Christ's suffering. What is Christ's suffering? Self-control, righteousness. Obey what God says. We have to go through Christ's suffering. So we don't want to obey. When we obey God and live, we know that how much it is suffering. That's the reason many people are not choosing to obey God. It is a suffering for God. They want to be free. They want to enjoy this world. They want to enjoy their flesh. They want to be how they are. So what Peter is telling, we are suffering. So when we go through our various kinds of problems, we should understand we are sharing Christ's suffering. 1 Peter 3:14, and do not take the trouble as an attack upon us, and we don't mourn and groan and say that what I have done to deserve this sort of life. Never. This is what everyone, it's not only I know that you are thinking personally, why I have done, what I have done to have a life like this. Each and every person will think the same thing, my friends, understand. So you should never think like that. Everybody in this world will go through one or the other trouble. The person whom you believe he is the luckiest person, you don't know the negative side of him, what he is suffering. He will just hide and show as if he is happy always and nothing wrong with him. But you should practice to rejoice. Bible says rejoice. Trouble make you grow in Christ's character, self-control from our flesh, and help you learn about yourself, that what you have not known before. That's what James goes on to say in James 1:4, that you may be perfect and complete and lacking nothing. Followers of Christ can rejoice always because their joy isn't based on the circumstances, but based on God and their salvation. So does rejoicing always means that you always go around with a smile on your face and you never be sad, depressed, or upset, or grieved? No. Some believers seem to think so, and if you ask them, how are you? They will tell, I'm happy, I'm always praising God. They think that it is unspiritual to reply that they have some problem or they are struggling from some issues. So if rejoicing always means always being cheerful and never feeling sadness, then we have a problem. As Jesus Christ faced with the cross, he prayed with loud crying and tears, Hebrews 5:7 says, and 2 Corinthians 6:10, Paul said about himself, as sorrowful, yet always rejoicing. As sorrowful, yet always. This should be our testimony. Yes, we have painful situation, but we know that God is in control. God will take care of our problems, and God will give us solutions in his time. We have to wait for his time. That's what we don't have. We are impatient people. Definitely things will change, my friends, if we trust God and walk in his ways. So our joy doesn't depend on the circumstances, but our joy depends on God and in our salvation. In Romans 12:15, Paul says, rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. That doesn't mean that we should exhort the people who are weeping to keep weeping. But he says to understand the feeling of the people and teach them to stop being in that feeling. We have to teach them. We have to make them understand. Because people in this world, they don't know how to be happy. They will be happy if good things happen to them. But Bible says rejoice always. We can. Hallelujah. So rejoice always doesn't mean that deny your feelings and never feel sad regarding the trials that God brings into our life to train us as children. The Bible acknowledges in Hebrews 12:11, all discipline for the moment seems not to be joyful but sorrowful. When trial comes, we are sorrowful. Yes, that pain will come. Why? Things are happening. Why our family members are behaving like this? Or why this mishap happened? That sorrow will come. But we should know that God has a purpose for everything. So we should accept them as they are. And we should learn to rejoice. Then only we can train righteousness. And Bible is telling. So when we go through Hebrews 12:11, all discipline for the moment seems not to be joyful but sorrowful, yet to those who have been trained by it, afterwards it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness. So the command to rejoice always have to be viewed not primarily as the matter of feeling rather than of obedience. When we are in difficult trials or if the people are ill-treated us, we have a choice either to focus on our trials and lapse into self-pity, or we can set our mind on the things of above. Colossians 3:1-4 and 1 Peter 3:9 says, do not repay evil for evil. That is our human character, revenge, isn't it? Revenge is dwelling in every human character. Please accept my friends. Don't tell that whenever I preach something or when Holy Spirit is convicting you. It is not that I know your character, but Holy Spirit will convict you. That time, never justify and say, no, this character is not with me. Maybe for someone. Yes, revenge is there in every person. So Bible says in 1 Peter 3:9, do not repay evil for evil, reviling for reviling, as our flesh demands that you may obtain a blessing. How do we get blessing? In Jesus Christ, not by prayer. That is what everyone wants. In this world, many people will pray. Then why do you need Jesus Christ to live in your old life and pray and get what you want? No. We sang the song. Holiness. Holiness, that's what he needs. Righteousness, that's what he needs. Faithfulness, sincerity, that's what he needs. That we don't know how in our human nature, in our blood, that is not there. In Christ, we have to develop. That is Christian life. That is born again. You are born again in Christ. Hallelujah. As Paul commands in Philippians 4:4, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice, the phrase in the Lord. Okay, not in the circumstances. In the Lord. We should practice and learn to rejoice in the Lord. Hallelujah. In the keys, our joy cannot be totally obvious or totally be not in our circumstances. So these words in 1 Thessalonians 5:16-18 are the principles for our inner life. Principle to live above our emotions and feelings. Instructions on how we should behave towards God. Did you get me? It looks very impossible when we see the commandments in 1 Thessalonians 5:16-18, which says, rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks whatever happens. It looks like an impossible commandment in the flesh. Yes, it is. But this is what we have to develop in Christ with the help of the Holy Spirit. We can. We have a loving God who is our Father. If you love your father, if you care your father, if you know that your parents will care you, brothers and sisters, you should understand we have a heavenly Father who will never leave us, never forsake us. Even if our own mother who gave birth, who leaves us, he is the person, he is the God who will never leave us, never. That understanding should have, that attachment we should receive, that love we should receive. See how you can trust a dear person. How? Yes, everybody will be trusting one person at least in life. God Almighty is more than that, understand. He is living for you. He is caring you. He knows what you are going through. He wants to change your situations. Understand, my friends. That's the reason. But one thing we have to do. Rejoice. Yes, problems will come. Difficulties will come. Pain will come. God is in control. Rejoice. Thank you, Jesus, for everything. Pray continually. Give thanks. This is what Bible commands. So these words in 1 Thessalonians 5:16-18 are for our inner life. That will control our emotions. That will control our thought life. Hallelujah. This is teaching us our behavior towards God Almighty. But we are always grumbling. No joy. No thankful heart. Always grumbling. Always grumbling. As if God has not done anything. People are also like that only, you know. You do everything to them. One thing if you don't do, they'll think you have never done anything. Isn't it? We are also like that only. No grateful heart. Hallelujah. So we need to remind ourselves that the good news is the good news of gospel. That glad tidings of great joy. Sadness and sorrow befall in us, in our life. Tears come, disasters strike. But our attitude should be joyful. Friends, you have to practice this. How many sermons you might have heard about this? Isn't it? How many times I have preached this? Or you might have heard from some other person? You have read these verses? But did you or are you practicing this commandment of rejoicing always? This is a deadly sin in you if you are not. So, if we understand or if we start practicing, we will no more grumble and angry toward God and people. That is the minimum standard of a born again person. How do you know that you are a born again person? These three things will be continual. These three things are the continual action, Bible says. If you are a born again person, you will be happy always. You will be praying always. You will be thankful for everything. This is the minimum standard of a born again person, my friends. Understand? It's not that you are always praying, reading the Bible. You are always in your prayer room. No joy. Always grumbling. Always murmuring. Hallelujah. So, person who work in a perfume factory, breathes the aromas around him every day, isn't it? They filter into his clothing, penetrate his skin, even fills his lungs. His very skin seems to discharge the pleasant fragrance. He becomes a walking perfumery. That should be happening to us after we are born again. Did you get me? You know that. Go and work in a perfume factory. You don't have to pray nowhere. Because all the time you are working in the perfume factory. When you come out, everywhere, even if you have bath, you will be smelling that perfume that was there in the company. Isn't it? The same way should be our attitude or our behavior or our nature, our emotions, our thinking. After we are born again, you should be reading the word of God. You should be studying the word of God. You should pray. You should have fellowship with the believers. Huh? Sunday you will come. Hello, praise the Lord. You will tell you are seeing them next Sunday. In between, no meeting. That will not happen. All the time your fellowship is with the worldly friends and worldly relatives. That will not happen. You should try and mingle with the believer friends. Fellowship, that is called fellowship. Hallelujah. So when worries and anxieties, disappointment are real and existing and they are our part of life, joy of the Lord will strengthen us, isn't it? When we are downward, we are depressed, all our energy will be drained. Be happy, you see the energy that comes, isn't it? You feel like doing things, but if you are depressed, if you are sad, You don't feel like doing anything. Why? There is no joy of Lord in your life. Hallelujah. If the joy of God is in your life, you will be doing it from morning till evening. You will be running around working. Working for God. If you are working outside in the office, everywhere you will be energetic. Through you, the aroma will be flowing to other people. Hallelujah. That is a Christian, my friends. Understand? Wonderful Jesus. So rejoicing always is a conscious attitude, and it is a contentment of what we have and what we are facing daily. Hope and happiness that comes from deliberately focusing on Jesus Christ and his promises and his eternal treasures. That's the reason Bible says, if you gain the whole world but you forfeit your soul, what will you gain? All the time you are out to gain money, position, education. No time. Call the people. No time. Everywhere one thing they like is what in their lifetime. 24 hours they don't have time. They engage their time for their worldly purpose. That's the reason at the end of the day you see how the sadness and disappointment and worries hit you. Are you happy? Even if you pray, happiness will not come. Hallelujah. So it's a deliberate attempt. People around us can be unruly, at home, in the office, everywhere. Please understand, people are people everywhere. In the family, in the working place, anywhere you go, you get the same set of people, because the same set of people are there everywhere. Unruly people, proud people, egoistic people, jealous people, who will ill-treat us. Okay? So, and even they will be rude and they will be inhuman. Some people you cannot even see a human nature, isn't it? There are people. In your family also such people will be there. In the office you can see such people everywhere. They will disappoint us. They will worry us. They will make us gloomy. In the midst of all, you should know how to behave. You should know how to face. That is the reason you need constant praying. We are coming there only. So such people will naturally make us worry, angry, gloomy, discouraged. But we should draw the sap of joy from the Spirit of God living inside and from the Word of God. That should transform our thinking. Thus, our response to adverse circumstances and uncomfortable people can be joyful always. Please understand, my friends, joy is a spiritual weapon against God, Satan. Please understand, my friends. If you are joyful, Satan cannot attack you. Why always Satan is attacking? You are hearing about Satan, 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 Satan. Believers will, because you don't have any joy. No happiness. You are not thankful for what all God is doing in your life. That's the reason, more than God's hand, what you are seeing in your life, Satan's hand, isn't it? This is true. Hallelujah. So joy is a spiritual weapon against frequent attack of Satan. Like the person who works in a perfume factory will become a walking perfumery, the believer who walks in the Spirit can be joyful at all circumstances, because he studies the word, store them in his heart, and he will think about that. He prays to obey. The word of God will overtake his negative thinking. Because see, many of you are not able to change your thinking because you are poor in Bible studying, isn't it? You spend the least hours for Bible study. You cannot control the thinking. Who is our many? And many will tell that, sister, I don't have memory power. It is not from our memory power, my friends. Understand? Holy Spirit will remind us what we have read. I remember when I was going through tough time, when nobody was with me, because that much I have read Bible reading when I was working. Those days I used to tell you, I have told you already this. We could install the Bible app in the mobile. There was no mobile at that time. I used to read how many Bibles are torn, you know. That much I have read. So whenever I used to go through the problems, word will come. That will comfort me. I will obey. Then I can see the hand of God. That's how I have grown in Christ. Alone. Anywhere I go, New Testament used to be there. Small New Testament I used to carry. Anywhere I am, I used to read. That much I was thorough in the Bible. So it is not that my memory power was bringing all those verses into my mind. When I was going through the struggles, words will come, strengthen me. He is the God, my friends, understand? Hallelujah. But we do struggle with studying the Bible, memorize and meditate because we don't find pleasure in it. It feels like a burden and a mere duty, and that won't attract us. We have other things to read. Many people will tell, I have no reading habit. Please don't tell that. If you don't have a reading habit, you should create a deliberate reading habit for Bible. It's not that because of your talent or your nature of reading, you are reading the Bible. Even I also don't read that much. I'm not a reading person. But for the information, I will read, that's all. But Bible, I have read. Hallelujah. So, don't think other things are more important and Bible is not interesting. He is your help, my friends. Understand, God is your help. When nobody is there, God will come for your help through His word and He will strengthen, and that time you will get an extraordinary faith and strength you will get. Yes, this is what God says. I will obey. This is correct. This is called God, my friends. Understand. Hallelujah. Our hearts incline in other things and do not incline the word of God. But what Psalmist says in Psalm 1:1-2, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked. See, many people will come and advise you when you are in the problem. You see, who are they? The worldly people. Isn't it? Worldly people's counsel will not help us. You should understand, because they don't know God. So what Psalmist says, blessed is the person who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the way of sinners, but he delights in the law of God, and on the law he meditates day and night. Next commandment following after rejoicing is pray continually. 1 Thessalonians 5:17. God commands us to pray without ceasing, but obviously, this doesn't mean that we must pray in every waking moment. A person with a bad cough does not cough continually, isn't it? But often, he will cough often and repeatedly. Even so, our prayer should be frequent and persistent, like the friend who came at midnight to ask for bread, which Jesus explained in Luke 11:5-13. Like that friend, we should keep on knocking the door till God opens the door for us. Like the widow who kept bothering the unjust judge, that is explained in Luke 18:1-8. Prayer is a practice that we have to cultivate. Don't say that I don't have. See, I cannot pray like how you are praying. You have some inclination. No. Even I too never knew to pray, my friends. Understand, I was struggling. It is not that I knew to pray. I never knew to pray, but I know that we have to pray continually. I was forcing myself to pray, so now it has become a practice. So don't tell that, oh, I don't know how to pray. I cannot pray like how you are praying. I don't have that talent. I cannot do that. Never say that. Everybody can do. Hallelujah. So prayer is a practice to cultivate. To pray constantly means prayer is recurrent, something we have to keep on doing frequently, in a perpetual pattern. 1 Thessalonians 3:10, Paul said, night and day we pray most earnestly that we may see you again and supply what is lacking in your faith. See what Paul has done to meet the people. Because there was difficulties to meet the people. Day and night they were praying. See? How important is prayer? Here people are prayerless. And you come and do God's work. You cannot do. Day and night. Constantly you have to pray to get anything done. Hallelujah. So here this indicates that the intense earnestness and anxiety of the apostle caused him to pray day and night. Paul wasn't literally on his knees around. That is not possible for anyone. But his prayers were frequent and recurrent. He should pray continuously for the things that trouble us, and we should pray continuously to control our every character, not only ours. We should pray for each other also. Ephesians 6:18. So don't abandon God of love and hope, saying that there is no use in praying. If your answer is late, He will answer our prayer. Hallelujah. We need to keep praying. We have to wait for His time. As we face each new challenge of the day, and if you don't obey this command to pray continuously, the result will be frustration, irritation, lack of peace, confusion, short temper, weariness and discouragement. I know that you are all experiencing this. Why? Because of the lack of your prayer. Praying without ceasing doesn't take the place or time in prayer. It's our heart attitude which we have to develop in Christ. When our thoughts turn to worry and anxiety, discouragement and anger, we have to consciously and frequently turn our every negative thoughts and every anxiety, every worry into prayer. Before also I have preached this. See, by worrying you will not gain anything. Turn your worry and anxiety into prayer. You should practice. It won't come. It won't come, my friends, for anyone. You have to practice. That's what I am teaching. Philippians 4:6, Paul commands us to stop being anxious. Instead, in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, let our request be known to God. As we go through the day, prayer should be our first response and weapon to every fearful situation. For every anxious thought, the lack of prayer will cause us to depend on ourselves and natural sequences. And believe me, you will be exhausted and tired of the problems in life if you don't practice to pray continually. You will feel like committing suicide if you have lack of prayer. Understand? Your born again life will not help you to live continuously with happiness, but your prayer, continuous prayer. And for Christians, prayer should be like breathing. You should not have to think to breathe, isn't it? Because the atmosphere exerts pressure in your lungs and essentially forces you to breathe. That is why it is more difficult to hold our breath than to breathe. Similarly, when we are born again into the... you understand, isn't it? What I told you now? The atmosphere exerts pressure into our life, lungs, and we don't have to think of breathing, isn't it? It comes. That pressure will make us breathing continually. In the same way, when you are born again into God's family, we have spiritual warfare. Hallelujah. In the spiritual atmosphere where God's presence and God's grace exert pressure on the influence of our life, and Satan will intensify our pressure so that we should leave God. Please understand, that is the reason Jesus commands us to pray continually. Looking at this, you may think, God can tell pray. Who can pray always? We have our own work. You should understand, God is not a man to tell foolish things. We have that much problems in our life. In all our problems, understand my friends, learn to pray. Learn to pray. It is not that you have to close your room and pray. Wherever you are, in your working place, in your own family, anywhere, you can keep praying. Hallelujah. So prayer is the normal response to that pressure. You should practice to turn every pressure into prayer. Unfortunately, many believers hold their spiritual breath for a long time, thinking brief moments with God like 5 minutes prayer, 10 minutes prayer, maximum half an hour prayer. You're holding your spiritual breath, my friends. Understand? They think that is sufficient for their spiritual survival. Rest of the time, they don't commune with God because they are too busy in other things and they waste their time in. So what happened? What is leading you? What is ruling you? Negative thinking, isn't it? If you don't have continual prayers, Nothing other than continue negative thinking will lead us and ruin us. I should tell, rejoice always and pray without ceasing are related, because it's through continuous prayers we can be joyful, and through joyful attitude we can have the continual prayers. Why continual prayers are not coming? First of all, you are not joyful. Hallelujah. Prayer is a language of trusting God. If we can understand that, joy can change our mood, isn't it? Just now I told you, if you are gloomy, depressed, we don't feel like doing anything, but if you are happy, we feel like doing everything, isn't it? The same way, see, if you know what benefit can give the continual joy, same benefit, friends, understand, give continual prayer, believe me. Continual joy and continual prayer. 1 John 5:14-15, Bible says, according to God's will, whatever we ask, God will hear. And if God hears, God will answer our prayers. So, continuous prayers can help us to live the life mindful of God. And see, continual prayer. We will, through continual prayer, we will be mindful of God, who is always good, merciful, and he who is ready to help us, who is the respecter of principle, who wants to obey us and live. Only through constant prayers we can love each other. Please understand, only through, if you are struggling with your sins, understand what you like is constant prayer. In every areas of your life you need, wherever you are finding it hard to obey, to love the people, to forgive the people, to adjust with the people. Okay, why you are not able to have self-control? Because you are lacking continual self-prayer for any area. Please understand, that's why sometimes I get angry on the people who keep falling in the same sin, same temptation, because they lack prayer. If there is a determination to come out from that temptation, and if you have a prayer life, definitely you will be a testimony. You don't have a testimony because in the first place, I do believe you don't need, you want to enjoy that temptation. If you want to come out from that, only you can pray, isn't it? Prayer comes out of decision. Hallelujah. So, through the constant prayers, families will be knit together, enemies will be reconciled, individuals will be saved, church will grow in quantity and in quality. What our church requests, continual prayers, not Thursday prayer, Sunday prayer, Saturday prayer, continual prayers for the church members. What you are praying? Are you praying for the people to be saved and come to the church continuously? Continuously, I'm not that. I'm sure that many of you are not doing. You may be praying in 5 minutes or 10 minutes. That itself is something you are doing for me. Not even for God. Otherwise, what pastor will think or guidance may come, isn't it? Continually, God send the people to our church. Let the people be saved. Let them understand the truth, oh God. You should pray. Keep praying. Anywhere you are, you should be praying. Hallelujah. So, but when constant prayerlessness is prevalent in individual and church members' life, that is an indicator of our lack of concern for what God asked us to do and what God expects from us. Prayerlessness is we turn our back on what God desires us to do. Please understand. That's what. When you have a desire, you will pray. Prayer will come. Because you don't know. So many of you are struggling in many areas because you don't want to come out from that temptation. You want to enjoy your flesh. I know. Sometimes you don't believe. Without my knowledge, I feel so much anger on you. I will think, why I'm feeling this much anger on that person? Then I can understand what you are doing. That's the reason I tell. I don't chuma tell anything. My friend, I'm standing for Christ. I'm accountable for you. Chuma, I don't tell I'm feeling angry on you. I feel so much anger on you because I know your heart desire. God will let me know. Please understand. And you are telling, no, I am praying, I am doing, but still, that is your testimony. I am doing everything. God is not capable. Your reply shows God is not capable, isn't it? Hallelujah. So prayerlessness is our, or we turn our back on what God desires us to do. It is an indicator of lack of concern for the advancement of God's kingdom in you, in your family, in the church, and in this world. Please understand. Who will pray for the people to be saved? The born again people. If you don't pray, who will pray? Who will pray that let your kingdom come, let your will be done? Who will pray, my friends, understand? Everyone in this world is praying, let my will be done, let my kingdom be done. God bless me, bless me, bless me, bless me, me and my maximum, my family. That is the prayer of the whole world, isn't it? And you are prayerless. Or you are telling, yeah, I'm praying. How much? I prayed at night. Then the whole day there is no prayer. That is called prayerlessness. The lack of constant and continual prayer is prayerlessness. Please understand. Lack of continual prayer is prayerlessness. Don't tell that, yeah, I prayed half an hour early morning. Over. Then you have switched off the prayer mode. That is not called prayer. Anywhere you are, my friends, while shopping you can pray. While having food you can pray. Hallelujah. And prayerlessness is a sin, for Samuel 12:23 says, a happy and cheerful heart and a constant prayer life are the matter of cultivation. We cannot afford to abandon ourselves entirely to our moods. Don't say that you don't have moods. That's the reason. Go and meet with the believer friends. If you are sitting at home, your mood will not change. Or if you are going and meeting with your worldly friends, you will get some more pressure and you come back. That time you will be okay. But you, at the end of the day, the pressure will be too much. But you go and meet with the believer friends fellowship. The least thing our children of God are ignoring is the fellowship with the children of God. They don't want to meet the church friends. My friends are there. They are smart. Yes, they may be smart, my friends. You may think spiritual people are dull. They are smartless. They are humble people. Outside, smart people are arrogant, proud, egoistic people who don't know. You call them to church, will they come? That shows their pride inside. That shows that they don't want to change. They know what is happening in the church. They will be in all their sins. They don't want to change. That's why they are reluctant to come. Hallelujah. So we should, if we are moody, we should anoint our heads and wash your face. You should do that purposely. And Proverbs 15:13 and Proverbs 17:22 says, a cheerful heart is a good medicine. Crushed spirit dries out the bones. We can promote a cheerful heart by dwelling in the bright things of the life, counting the blessings that God has given to us, and how we can be joyful always without the presence of God or without the presence of the believers, without mingling with the believers, my friends, understand? So the third commandment in the series is in verses 16, give thanks at all circumstances, for that's the will of God for you in Christ. It's tough to remember and to give thanks to God at all circumstances. It is it, isn't it? But this also we have to develop as a character, as a Christ character, especially when we are going through a difficult season. Our troubled times when we often distract us from the reality of God being in control of our life. Ephesians 5:20, Paul states, always giving thanks for all things in the name of Lord Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Father. Giving thanks is in every situation. Doesn't mean that we must be happy with every situation. It is not that we are happy with the situation, but we are thankful to God for all what God has done in our life. We should understand the fact that God has not abandoned us or in our tough time. He will take us through. See, when tough time comes, when problem comes, we'll think that God has abandoned us. No, we should only understand the truth that God will take us through tough times. We have to trust in God. Hallelujah. We should accept the truth that always we are ready to do the righteousness, and remember to control grumbling and murmuring and be happy in our troubles and difficult times. By faith, we should say, Lord, I trust that you allow the situations for me, so you are in control of this difficult situation. You should trust. Yes, you are going through a difficult situation. You are going through a fearful situation. You may be thinking that nobody is there to help you. You think that everything is gone. Hold on, my friends. Trust God. Pray. Lord, I know that you are in control of the situation. You are watching what I am going through. Please help me. You should pray. You should trust God like an innocent baby. Hallelujah. So you should say that I submit, sovereign God, I submit myself to your hand and I thank you for. Don't grumble and murmur and tell why this has happened. Why? Why? I should have not faced these things in my life. Then I could have been happy. Isn't it? All such dialogues will come from us. We should stop. That is the natural human dialogues from a person. You should stop and you should be accepting that difficult situation, what you are going through. Depend on God. Never grumble, never murmur. So knowing that God will work together everything for good, and then we can rejoice and give thanks, and we can control our grumbling and murmuring. Thankfulness will be our heart attitude when we trust God. Did you get me? Why we are trembling and grumbling grumbling and murmuring for everything? Because of lack of. You may say that, no, I believe in God. But that faith is not enough. If you trust God, thankfulness will come. You know that, yes, God is living for me. God has sent Jesus Christ into this world to die for me. Personally accept it, my friends, understand? Personally receive Jesus Christ into your life as a personal savior. He is called a personal savior. Then you will understand he is there for me. So the thankfulness will be our heart attitude when we trust God. If we are not thankful, then we are not trusting God. This attitude of ours is illustrated with the children of Israel. God delivered Israelites from slavery in Egypt by 10 miraculous plagues. You know that. And while Egyptians, and he spared Israel, God miraculously brought them through the Red Sea and closed the water on the top of the pursuing Egyptian army. You would think that by this point they would be thankful. They will be thankful for God and they will be trusting God. But we read in Exodus 15:22 through 24 that they went, when they went in the wilderness, when they were lacking water, what they did? They were grumbling and murmuring. Why you have brought us to this place? We could have been there in Egypt. Isn't it? That is how believers are. They didn't trust God, and who had powerfully saved from the slavery and could provide water in the desert. If you are worried and sad, if you are grumbling, you are not trusting God, my friends. If your trust is in God, it is proved by, or if you say that you have trusting God, or your trusting God is strong, you will stop grumbling and murmuring, and immediately you start praying in every troubled situation, being joyful and thankful to God. So it is much easier to sulk about our disappointment, hardship, than to be thankful for even in the midst of hardship, our carnal nature. See, we should accept. First, we should accept who we are. We are grumbling people. We are murmuring people. We are not happy with anything, isn't it? Even if whatever you want, if a person is giving you are not happy. That is the testimony of you and me, my friends, understand? We are ungrateful people. We have to develop this character in Christ. Hallelujah. Our carnal nature long to be fed and encouraged into pity parties instead of focusing our minds on thanking God for the goodness and his purpose. We have to discipline our thoughts to remain thankful in difficult times. We can best remain in our thought through the constant influence of the scriptures. That's what I'm telling. So all such time, my friends, God has to help you, means you have to study the word of God. Without the word of God, God will not help you. Those who are not finding time in the word of God, I request you, keep reading the word of God. You don't tell you don't have time. Out of 24 hours, you are no. Don't tell that if you are a student, don't tell that I have enough to study. Exam is coming. So many excuses they say. Or you have so much, those who are working, they say that you come to my office, then you will know my work. Don't tell any excuse. Or the housewife, you ask, hayo, elli dema time, yavagalu cooking, cleaning, washing. Who has got time in this world? You tell me. Then by Bible is telling, whoever you are, however you don't have time, my friends, find time and study the word. Study the word. Keep studying that word. Don't tell that I have read Bible once. Many people will tell with their pride, feather on their cap, and they will tell that, yes, I have read Bible, full Bible one time. I read full Bible. Over. Keep reading, keep reading, keep reading, especially New Testament. Keep reading, keep reading. Hallelujah. Then when you go through the struggle, you will get the word of God. Nobody will be around you. God will come through his words, my friends, understand. So we have to discipline our thoughts to remain thankful in difficult times, and we can best retrain our thoughts through the constant influence of the scripture. Proverbs 4:23 says, above all, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. I told you, your thoughts should be influenced by the Holy Spirit. Otherwise, you will be influenced by your own spirit. You see, whose spirit is influencing you? You know. Whose spirit is influencing you? If Holy Spirit is influencing you, you are a happy person, my friend. You are a prayerful person, my friend. You are a joyful person. You are a thankful person, even if you have nothing. Even if your prayers are not, many prayers are not answered. If you are such a person, many testimonies already you might have got. You will have the hope. Yes, my answer is coming. Hallelujah. Because 1 John 5:14 and 17 says, according to God's will, whatever we ask, God, according to God's will, we should pray. He will hear. If he hears, he will answer our prayers. Hallelujah. So it doesn't take much time for us to dip ourselves into the problems without recognizing our carnal nature of unthankfulness heart, isn't it? And we forget that even in our need, or we forget that God has provided many blessings. He even blesses with more than what we deserve. All these stuff we will forget. Our true motives spring out from our heart when our grateful and our ungrateful heart is revealed through our actions. Our ungrateful heart will be revealed through our actions. Did you get me? I don't have time to explain that. I feel like explaining, but our time is up. What is your action? Action proves your ungrateful heart. Hallelujah. I will preach one day. Wonderful God. We should understand that our heart attitude needs to change. Bible commands us to count our blessing, but we know that what we will count, our worries and our negatives and our problems. When we grumble, we are continually in a situation that God has allowed for our cleansing. Did you get me? If you are grumbling, worried, you are grumbling about the situation that God has given you to work out your salvation. He will stop that. He will remove the grace from you. He will put you in the world. You may be coming to the church. Hallelujah. That is the reason Philippians 2:14 and 15 says, do everything without murmuring and grumbling. Disputing, in fact. We should recognize our ungrateful heart that exists in our human nature. You know that. Friends, from today's message, you should get something that is dwelling inside of you. Your unhappy nature, your prayerlessness, your ungrateful heart. So we should recognize the ungrateful heart that exists in our human nature. Grateful heart is an antibiotic to cure many of your diseases. Please understand. Headache, back pain, leg pain, pain of different sort, all these are coming from ungrateful heart. And gratefulness is an antibiotic. You don't have to go to medical shop. Right in front of you, it is there. Even if I send the message, you will not. You have to go to doctor and take the medicine, because you don't want to change your ungrateful heart. You will always grumble. You will grumble. You see what good God has given to you. If your flesh is not allowing, pray, God help me to understand what you have done in my life. God will remind you. You'll be surprised. Your pride may not recognize, my friends, the good things that God has given you. If you think that you have only the situations to grumble, God has not blessed, that is your pride. Pray. Pray, God, show me what you have done. In your pride only you pray. Show me what you have given me. Then God will show. You will be ashamed. You will roll on your floor, my friends. And you will cry, oh, this much God has done. What an ungrateful person I am. Hallelujah. So grateful heart is a medicine, antibiotic. I feel the tremendous presence of God over here. Only grateful heart can rejoice always, pray continually, and give thanks in everything. So don't disobey this commandment to pray or rejoice always, pray continually, and give thanks, and commit the most common and deadly sin among the